there a sob within your peaceful world? I has not seen, ear has not heard what God has ready for those who love Him. Spirit of love, come give us the mind of Jesus. Teach us the wisdom of God. I has not seen, ear has not heard what God has ready for those who love Him. take my hand. I'll lead you to salvation. Take my love, for love is everlasting. And remember the truth that once was spoken. To love another person is to see the face of God.
Lord God, whose Son left us in the sacrament of his body food for the journey, mercifully grant that strengthened by it, our brother Robert may come to the eternal table of Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
I know my dad really liked that Les Mis song, and that's a hard one to follow. Hello everyone. My name's Dan Grubbs, and I'm the fifth of the six Grubb boys for your bingo cards at home, and it's nice to see you all here today. I know Bob would really be appreciative and feel the love here, but you know, we speak of Bob here today, but to remember, and to remember is to live. We speak about Bob and all his traits and habits and grace, hopeful to seed those stories into our minds and our souls, and that they carry us forward. Lately, I've been reviewing old text messages and emails and voicemails from Bob, scrolling through to keep his voice alive. Naturally, he was most prestigious with his voicemails, staking a claim for what I have to believe is the longest voicemails on record. I really wasn't sure sometimes if he was leaving a message or if he was just really pretending to have a two-way conversation just to amuse himself, and you were the one selected that day. However, in many of those voicemail conversations, I came away with learning something, a piece of knowledge he would share. He was so naturally bright, but he loved to test himself and prove it, like when he would make me keep score nightly of his Jeopardy battles with my mom to see who could come out on top. I know he would actually probably perform pretty well with Ken Jennings these days. He wasn't just bright, he was also really talented. Talented for the arts, drawing, writing, acting, even singing, with a lot of help from Marie Cochran. But also an unbelievable creativity spark. Zeal for spontaneity and a pinpoint palette. He was unique. In his favorite 49er terms, he would definitely be a high draft pick with great potential that would stir the pot. He would never give up on a play, really and super reliable, and as well as be friends with the whole team. But what I know many of you would appreciate about Bob was his sense of humor. For early on as a kid to his last weeks, Bob saw humor in life, in how we are and how we carry on in our days. He loved Calvin and Hobbes, and when I was growing up, he'd make me see the simple treasure of a comic strip each day before heading off to school. Mad Magazine was his manifesto. The irreverent humor lampooning American institutions matched Bob to a T. His humor was always there, even when he fought cancer. He'd be talking on the phone or in person, relating a story, and find something so funny in what he was saying that he would start laughing at the absurdity of his situation. Like he loved his own jokes. He loved his jokes more than anyone. He expected you to see it too. He loved movies, all genres. It was really a period after Bob finished college that we would watch so many movies together, many from the comforts of my parents' home. Bob's grand idea in those days was to open an art house in my parents' family room, charging admission to all the neighborhood kids so they could appreciate our taste in movies. We spent a good portion of our lives watching and rewatching Bridge on the River Kwai, Max Dugan Returns, To Hell and Back with Audie Murphy. But there was a movie that Bob and I thought, and we particularly gravitated to, The Last of the Mohicans. There was so much that we loved about that movie, the music, the battles, the mountains, but it was a line from Daniel Day-Lewis that was so cheesy and was so good at the same time that ever since any time we'd both see the movie on TV, we'd wait for the scene, and then we'd call the other person. And then we'd have to say the line to each other, no matter where we were or what we were doing. We had to have done this at least 50 times over the last 30 years. You know, and it's been 30 years since it premiered, and just this past summer I received a voicemail from Bob. It was 5:30 in the morning, and he was in a lot of pain. He called to tell me he loves me. He woke up thinking of me. And of course, he was watching Last of the Mohicans. I listened to this voicemail many times recently. It means a lot to me. Because in life, we hope to have connections and relate to one another. A bond. We will hope to have shared experiences because we know we are so much sweeter for it. And we don't always know which experiences will become those lifelong memories. There was also one experience, though, that was hard to forget. Naturally, in the arts, Bob was a big reader, and I also gravitated towards many of the things that he would read. Bill Bryson was someone that we shared an appreciation for. And it was a book that Bill wrote about the Appalachian Mountains that inspired us to do the same and go traverse the trail. I was living in L.A., Bob in San Francisco, and we agreed to do it at the end of summer. I set out training every weekend in the San Gabriel Mountains, lugging 50 pounds on my back, thinking that that's what was most important. Well, Bob was sitting at home, reading about which berries would be okay to eat if we ran out of food. When I was getting all my gear ready, Bob was reading about the wildlife that we could run into and make sure either how to survive or how to kill it. Well, fast forward, it was our fifth day out hiking. And as we came down a ridge, who do we see spotting coming up that same ridge but a nice, hungry black bear? The bear rose and its ears perked up. Bob says to me, "Danny, we have two choices here. You either stand behind me or I stand behind you." And he goes, "Since I'm older, I'll decide. You get in front, you're taller." And in my days of, was this really happening here? I couldn't tell if this was a smart strategy that he had to save us both, or was really just for his survival. I said, "Did you read this? Is this what we're supposed to do?" He said, "No, I just thought of it." He said, "I should also probably tell you this now, but this morning before we left camp, I put all the food in your backpack." I yelled, "What? All the food?" He said, "Yeah, but I have the bear spray." Luckily for us, the bear was tired of our back and forth conversation and yelling and actually decided to head back up the ridge looking for someone else less talkative backpackers to go maul. Bob had faith in that bear, and I think that he would make the right choice. At least that's what I think. Bob had also grown in his spiritual faith in recent years in his own way. Seeing his mortality brought forward a depth of vulnerability, being open to the world, with you, with me. He acknowledged his journey that he had been on, his faults, and he had welcomed prayer into his life. He became driven by connecting with you and me. His spirit resided with displaying and showing love. Yet, he would have bouts of impatience and real pain, but he soldiered through looking to make the most of his time. Deanna is a blessed soul, and she has been with Bob through most everything. She and Noah were Bob's backbone, helping him meet the day and push on. I even know that just this past Christmas Day, just a few weeks ago. As he was weak, they both gave him the extra push. It was there at my mom and dad's house that Bob naturally gravitated to the kitchen. He supervised the roasting of the beef for my mom and dad. Simple touch of the beef, as only Bob could do. Mom, this still needs 5 more minutes. My parents sensed that Bob was presenting a last gift from the heart. Bob had become much more present in the last year or so. He found his place. It wasn't perfect, but it also didn't need to be. He took life for what it was, but also what it still could be. He sought you out. He shared a thought. He spent time. He shared a meal. He soaked up the sun. He tried to catch fish. There were small moments and some were big, but most importantly, there were Bob showing and giving his love. And what he loved more than anything, even the 49ers, was being a father. Being a father was something Bob looked forward to for many years. He tried it on for size with me and my little brother Ben. We were his muses. Later in life, as Bob and Deanna were about to welcome Noah into this world, he was so excited to be a father, and I was sure he was hoping to have a better student than me. When Noah was young, Bob would provide updates on Noah, bragging about his little accomplishments. He told me that he would love to explore the mind and memory of Noah. What was actually happening in there? He wanted to know really how he ticked, and Noah was a great student for Bob. Bob would share, discuss, and show Noah so many lessons and tips, and open his eyes to so many different adventures. It was also during his cancer battle that Bob refused serious pain medication, as he did not want to dull his emotions or his ability to function as Noah's father. He wanted to be totally present and participate in all of Noah's life. He tried to be the best father. In particular, he loved to teach Noah how to cook, naturally. Bob had a way of sharing knowledge, particularly with those younger than him. He taught with the gifts of knowledge and humor. Bob and Noah would make dinner together every night, their favorites being pizza and ribs. This was very important to Bob. Bob, more recently, was really looking forward to teaching Noah how to drive, and there was still so much he hoped for. Deanna has told me that most everything that Noah knows and is because of Bob. I know many of us here could say the same about something, or think back to the memories that you have with Bob and how he was knowledgeable, how he was instructive. How he was caring and with a great spirit and humor. I ask, Lord, please hold Bob in your arms, stand by his side, keep his humor in check, and also watch out. He may want to take over your kitchen.
One of my earliest memories of Bob takes me back to Christmas Eve when I was a little kid and he was a teenager. Bob offered me to sleep in his room that night so he could keep a watch for Santa and wake me up when he thought Santa was coming down the chimney. Bob unfortunately missed Santa that night. When he woke me up, Santa had left the house, but there under the tree were the presents. Bob made Christmas very special to me. Every year during the holidays, I think back to that time, and after becoming a parent, appreciate even more the effort Bob made for his little brother. As he grew older and started defining interests and activities, Bob was there as an active supporter. He was my campaign manager for student council in middle school and as a creative sounding board for my media pursuits. Bob loved recounting one episode of a TV show I made for the community access station Channel 30. The show profiled a restaurant downtown that made Philly cheesesteaks. The budding reporter here asked the teenager working in the restaurant's kitchen What temperature did he set the grill to cook the meat? 80 degrees, he said. What an idiot, Bob would say, and roil with laughter. I believe we left that kid's comment in the episode. The restaurant, unsurprisingly, is no longer in business. Our family, like many in this community, were diehard 49ers fans. So much so that if a game coincided with Mass, Bob would offer to drive the rest of the brothers to church. We'd stay in the parking lot, listening to the game on the radio. Then I would be summoned into the church, pick up the bulletin, and peek through those doors to see which priest was giving the sermon. The bulletin was evidence that we actually made it to Mass, and we can claim a lack of understanding if Mom ever quizzed us on the priest's sermon. Bob loved music, and he has been an influence on the rest of the brothers. I do remember a confused mailman coming to our house one time with CDs from Columbia House Music Club. The address was correct, but the name on the package was addressed to Jennifer Montana. That surely meant Joe Montana lived on Paseo del Cajon. Nope, it was just Bob getting a second Columbia House account. In 1994, Bob and I attended the 49ers-Eagles game, and that was the turning point to the road to the Super Bowl championship that year. In 2012, Bob and I attended our second game together. It was the one where Alex Smith was concussed and replaced by Kaepernick. And we know what happened that year, trip to the Super Bowl. Bob and I joked that the two of us together at a 49ers game had some special effect on their team's season. It was maybe fitting that the last time I saw Bob a few weeks ago in Los Angeles, when he came into the room, he was turning on the TV for what else but a 49ers game. As a teenager, Bob was there to take me to the DMV for my driving test. He waited for the test instructor to arrive at the car, and before wishing me well on that test, he ripped the worst-smelling fart in the car. As the instructor emerged into the car and absorbed that horrid stench, Bob was in the fresh air outside, laughing away. I love him for that moment in my life. I'm blessed to have worked with him at Wente Vineyards in those same teenage years and witness his prowess in the kitchen. I was so proud of my brother as the executive sous chef. Bob was once asked what his favorite day was, and he said it's a tie. The first good rain in the fall and the first real warm day in the spring. Both days had the most magnificent smell in the air. You could just smell the season's change. His favorite flower is the yellow freesia. He felt it's the best smelling flower. The flower also symbolizes joy, renewal, and friendship. You know, this past decade has really challenged Bob. It's limited the joy, it's tested the notion of renewal, but friendship and family kept him going through dark days. He said to me once, "I'm at the bottom of the ocean, 1,000 feet to the surface. I try to swim up, but I can't make any difference." He later said, "I'm still in pain, and I'm in a dark hole. But thankfully, I have a wonderful brother that cares for me and sees that I still have potential. I'll get through this with your help. Love you." Bob had creative potential in droves. We talked about TV shows and movies and YouTube videos that could be produced. Creative endeavors that never failed to elicit a stream of ideas. Here is one of his movie pitches I resurfaced from several years ago. He said, "I've been thinking about this for a long time. Kids playing basketball, it's never been done. Kids play football in Little Giants, hockey in Mighty Ducks, baseball in Bad News Bears, but none with basketball. Name one. I bet you can't. I've got the story, but I want the credit." So here's the story. A former NBA player has blown out his knee and has troubles off the field. His manager or agent gets him to agree to coach a young boy's basketball team. Their previous coach quit. This is a group of misfits: fat kid, skinny kid, black kid that can't dribble, small white kid, etc. He hooks up with the mother of a troubled kid and brings him into the group. There's also an outcast, a homeless kid, that just hangs around the gym. Eventually, we see he can shoot buckets when no one else is around. He's brought onto the team. These two kids, they change the dynamic of the team. They now start winning. Every other kid settles into a character position: set shot, three-pointer, defender, etc. They make the championship but lose by one. This is a story about character. You'll get a sequel where they will win. It's Rocky versus Rocky II. This is gold, Ben, Bob. Well, I recently co-founded a company that produces films, and I spoke to my partner earlier this week, and Bob, we agreed to option your idea. You're going to get the story credit. I love that Bob wants to tell a story about character. He had his own strengths and flaws. And when the phone rang, it wasn't entirely clear which Bob was on the line. Joyful, inebriated, melancholic. Now, Bob was once asked if he believes in the afterlife. He said yes. Watch the film, Defending Your Life, starring Albert Brooks and Meryl Streep. For an idea of the afterlife, I find interesting, he said. I really like this proposal that each person's decisions in life are taken away, are taken under review when they die, and then decided if they pass or need a redo. Pass and you move on, only with a boost in brain power and capacity. At an April 2020 Zoom family meeting at the start of COVID, the family entertained one another by playing instruments, dancing, and regaling each other with stories. My parents awarded Bob with the superlative, best recap of a fabulous life. He was feeling good then, even though he was also at the time signaling his end was near. He would tell me, I want to come to Los Angeles for, quote, no real reason except I miss you and I want to see you. Well, that's a lie. I have cancer and I want to see my friends and family before I die. I want to see you before I am in a hospital bed, before COVID catches me. Several years ago, Bob told me, I would love to be there along with you physically, but no, I'm always there with you mentally and spiritually. Do great things. I think about that today. Bob, I know you're with me mentally and spiritually, and I'll do great things in your honor.
So, good morning. Thank you all for being here. I'm Patrick, number three. Just real quick, you know you could come at 5 o'clock. You didn't have to sit out in the parking lot and listen to it. So that's what I did. I came at five on Saturday. So one thing that you've heard a lot about is Bob's passion for music. He loved it. It was, I think he gave all of us that little bug. Mine first was when we started listening to the radio and called in to try to get our songs played. So I think it's only fitting that we get a chance also to remember Bob in images and in music. And so I'd like you to have a look.
Is this life that we're living? Say the prayers of a thousand tongues into the grave wide open across the land. To the grave wide open across the land of blood. into the crate wide open across a land of love and dreams. I will save your heart from breaking. Won't you stop, please? Set me free.
Brothers and sisters, before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother Bob. May our fellow express our affection for him. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet him again, when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself.
May the choirs of angels come to greet you. May they speed you to paradise. May the Lord enfold you in his mercy. May you find eternal life. The It is he who protects me from harm. The Lord is the strength of my days. Before whom should I tremble with fear? May the choirs of angels come to greet you. May they speed you to paradise. May the Lord enfold you in his mercy. May you find eternal life.
Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our brother Bob in the sure and certain hope that together all who have died in Christ will rise with them on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings you bestowed upon Bob in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant. Help us remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our brother forever, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless us, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our Mass is ended. Go in peace.
Thanks be to God. The Lord rise up to meet you. May the wind be always with you. May the sun shine warm you always, till we meet again. May the rain fall softly on you. May the hand of God uphold you. May the road rise up to meet you. May the wind be always with you. May the sun shine warm you always, till we meet again. Christ before you, Christ behind you. Christ beneath you, Christ above. May the wind be always with you. May the sun shine warm you always, till we meet again. Christ to shield you, Christ be with you. Christ be with you now and always. May the road rise up to meet you. May the wind be always with you. May the sun shine warm you always, till we meet again.
Yeah. Please pass it on. We're going to be meeting at McKay's Tap House and Beer Garden following. We're going to be meeting at McKay's on Main Street. It's the tap house and beer garden for a reception. Tell everybody outside.